Hi, and welcome to Armed Forces Week at the National Cryptologic Museum. My name is Vince Houghton. I'm the director here at the museum. And along with me is Jen Wilcox, who is our director of education. We have a really unique opportunity today to look at the U.S. Navy cryptologic bomb in its natural habitat. Normally, this bomb is covered in a protective casing, but because we're fully immersed in a redesign of the museum, the case has come off because the bomb itself is moving. So you get a chance to see it up close and personal. I'd say you get a chance to touch it, but no, you don't get a chance to touch it. This is one of a kind. It's the only one in existence. There were a lot of these back in the 1940s, but today this is the only one that still exists. And this was created to defeat the German four-rotor Enigma that was created for use of the German submarines to try to knock off the American and Canadian capabilities of bringing supplies across the Atlantic Ocean to fight against the Germans during the war. The process to defeat the four-rotor Enigma and Enigma as a whole started over in the United Kingdom at Bletchley Park. But by the middle of the war, when the United States joined in, we too were brought into this empire, and we created a number of these four-rotor bombs in an attempt to help to break this almost unbreakable code. At least the Germans thought it was unbreakable, but we found a way. Now, as you can see, this is a massive machine, and there's a lot of moving parts, thousands of moving parts. So this wasn't something that could be run by just one or two people. In fact, it took dozens and dozens of people working round-the-clock shifts in order to make the bomb successful. The problem, of course, during World War II is a literal lack of manpower. Most of the men were sent overseas fighting the war. So how do you actually get the people necessary to work the bomb and break these codes? Well, in 1942, Franklin Roosevelt came up with a solution. And he created an organization, the United States Navy, called the WAVES. So Jen, can you talk a little bit about the WAVES, why they were created, how they were involved in cryptology, and of course, how they worked the bomb?
Sure. Well, the WAVES, which stands for Women Accepted for Volunteer Emergency Service, was created just a few months after the Army's version of the WACS, the Women Army Corps. And the WAVES were involved in every aspect of cryptology, from collecting all the way through distribution of the final product. And that included setting up the crypt analytic bombs that were working against the German Enigma machines. Now, other WAVES and mathematicians and civilians were the crypt analysts, and they would take the intercepted messages, work on them, and come up with a menu that they believed would help the bomb find the correct solution. And so these were sent down to the bomb deck. We had 121 of these machines located at Nebraska Avenue. They ran 24/7, and there were thousands of women covering these shifts running these machines. So they would take the menu, and they would set these dials according to the menu, which was a cipher letter going with an assumed plain text letter or its corresponding part. And they would set these dials, set the rotors, and literally just push a button. And then it would run for 20 minutes. When it was done, it would have two or three possible correct solutions, and the WAVE would take the printout off the printer here, and she would do a little bit of a check on it and then send it back to the crypt analyst. If they had the right answer, they yelled, "Jackpot!" And everybody stopped working on that one and moved on to the next, because there were so many of these messages that they had to try to find the keys for in order to read those Enigma messages.
And even if they found the key for a particular day, the Germans changed it every single day at midnight.
And not only that, but it wasn't just you broke the U-boats, you broke the Mediterranean U-boats, you had to break the North Atlantic U-boats. So there were networks all across the German Navy that they had to solve. That's why we needed so many of these machines.
So when the war ended, why is there only one left? Where did all the other ones go?
Well, they're big, they're heavy, they're classified, and you don't need them anymore. So they started to destroy them. And someone did say, "Excuse me, Admiral, we may need a few of these." They hung on to six. In the 1950s, two got rehabbed. This is the last remaining one.
Some of you may have ashtrays or parts of your cars that are made of the steel and iron from one of these old bombs. So as Jen mentioned, this is the last one, and this is the only place that you can see it. Unfortunately, we're closed right now, but the hope is that by this summer, we'll be back open for visitors, so you have to come check us out and check out the bomb and all the great artifacts that we have and the great new design of the National Cryptologic Museum. So on behalf of Jen Wilcox, my name is Vince Houghton, and everyone here at the National Cryptologic Museum, we'd like to wish you a happy Armed Forces Day, and we hope to see you here soon.